Hello and welcome, myself Rehan Ali, and in this video or in this series of videos I'm gonna show you how can we approach to write the code in C programming language for printing the different types of patterns. Just for the side note, we can write our code in any programming language to print the same pattern. There is just a difference of the syntax only. So for the demonstrating purpose, we'll write our code in C programming language here. But in the description of this video, you will find the link where I have uploaded source codes of the patterns in these four programming languages such as C, C++, Java and Python. And also for writing and executing our programs, I use VS Code or Visual Studio Code. You may use any IDE of your choice, but if you want to set up your VS Code for running C and C++ programs, you can watch this video that I am showing in iCard button above. You will also find the same link in the description of this video. So yeah, enough talks, let's get started. Alright, so in this video what we are gonna do is to write the code to print these square patterns, namely solid square, hollow square with cross and hollow square with diagonal. But before dive into it, what I want to do is to provide you some basics or the fundamental tools, and these tools will eventually become the basis for printing any kind of patterns. So now there is a concept of looping in programming languages. The loops are nothing but the iterative rule or structure that allows us to repeat the execution of some instructions till the condition stays true. We'll see this in action in a while. So in C programming language, there are basically three types of loops, such as for loop, while loop and do while loop. Although we can write our code by using any of the loops listed here, but in this series of videos we'll write our code by using the for loop because it's easy to understand, as all the three parts we'll find at the one place. See the syntax of the for loop here. It basically contains four parts, but the last part is the obvious one because eventually we need to execute some statement there. But these three parts, such as initialization, condition and steps, are the crucial one. First we'll see these parts in theory and then we'll see their practical implication. Here, the first part is initialization. As the name implies itself, this part is basically used for initializing our loop, or we can say that this is nothing but the entry point of the loop. Now, the second part is the condition. As the name suggests, there would be some conditions that will track whether the loop should continue its execution or should terminate it. If this condition evaluates to true, it means that loop will keep running, and when this condition becomes false, loop will get terminated automatically. Also, you have to keep this in your mind, for breaking or terminating our loop after having done intended task, we must need to tweak this condition in such a way that at some points it becomes false. Otherwise, loop will running for a lifetime, and this condition with respect to loops is also known as infinite loop, means the loop will keep running infinitely. And for achieving this purpose of terminating the loop in between, the third part comes into the picture. This third part is nothing but these steps. Here, we twist some value of the variable that is used in our condition part by either incrementing or decrementing its value, so that at a particular point, the condition will become false and the loop will get terminated. Alright, I know that this theory is very abstract, but don't worry, if you haven't understood any of the part or the whole explanation, now we'll see this in action by doing some practical work. Okay, so here we are gonna write these two programs first to better understand the working of the for loop. So first program is to print the table of any number, and the second program is for printing the tables of these numbers from 1 to 10. So this is the syntax of the for loop, we already seen it, but here I numbered it as they executes. We'll see this in a while. Like first initial part we'll execute, then we check the condition, if it's true then execute statement inside the block, then either increment or decrement this value and again check the condition and follow the steps as before. And when this evaluates to false, loop will terminate itself. So here I written solution of first problem as we discussed. This is the table of 7. We can change this value to print table of any number. But writing code like this is not efficient, and also this is very time consuming. You may think that you can write this printf statement in this way also, but again it is time consuming and also less efficient. You may argue that for this particular example, efficiency doesn't matter. I completely agree, but what if I tell you to print the same table 100 times instead of multiplying this table of value from 1 to 10, but now I want our output to be printed as multiplication from 1 to 100 as this. Will you write this code in the same way as we wrote earlier? Or will you try to find some better way to structure it? I'll choose the second option. Now we'll see how we can write solution of this problem using the for loop. Here, I first declared a variable start of data type integer and also the end condition variable to make it clear where to stop. Now I initialize our for loop by assigning start to 1. Here I declare some conditions as start is smaller than equals to end condition. I'll tell you in a while why I am giving this condition. Then we will increment start value by 1 as start equals to start plus 1. Then write these printf functions inside this for loop. In this way, now let's give it a try. We get the same output as before, but this time using our for loop. Now we'll see how it works. This part only runs once. After initializing, loop will never visit this part again. Here we are assigning value of start variable as 1. Now we check the condition as whether the start is smaller or equals to end condition. Yes, it is, because end condition has the value 10 and 1 is smaller than 10. Then we execute each statement inside the for loop block. Here we only use one statement to print the value of start variable. After executing all these statements, loop will visit to this part. Here we are incrementing value of start by 1, hence now value of start is nothing but 2. Then again check this condition. This time also the condition is true only, because 2 is smaller than 10. We again execute a statement inside this block and print the value of start. This is why we get value as 2 printed here. And again increment value, then check the condition and execute our block and so on. Now after printing 10, when we increment the value of start, it becomes 11. And now when we check this condition, this time it is false as 11 is not smaller or equals to 10. This is where our for loop get terminated. We can easily cross check it by printing a start value after our loop. Now run the code and see the output. Here you can see that value of start is 11. Now we get better understanding of working of this for loop. Also here, as we only interested to increment this value by 1, so instead of using this syntax, we can use shorthand increment operator. This simply means that we are incrementing this value by 1. Now we can multiply our table of variable with the value of start to get our actual result. And I also want our result to be printed as a single column, or we can say vertically, instead of printing it horizontally or in a single row. For this purpose, I'll use line break character here inside printf function. Now we get our output like this. Alright, so now we already understood the loop. We'll solve our second problem. This output looks something like table, in which these all are rows and these all are nothing but the columns, as you can see here. In our previous example, we already printed our output as a single column. Now revisit that example. Here we are printing this in a single column and multiple rows, for example 10 rows. To get this clear, we will append some equal sign here and then run this code. As you can see now, this output is clearly visible as rows and columns, means in the form of table. This equal sign here, we need to print the table of that particular number, like table of 1 here and table of 2 here and table of 3 here and so on. This problem we already had solved. What we did there, we had used for loop and run it 10 times as like this. This type of loop, in which the loop is inside the loop, is also known as nested loop. If you run this code, we get output something like this. Now we are very closer to the solution of our second problem. Here again, as we did before, we'll print table of these numbers. Now run this code. Congratulations, we did it. We are successfully write our code for both the problems. But here we make some improvement though. As we know, eventually we are gonna print the table of these numbers, and these numbers are nothing but the number of rows. So instead of using this table of variable, we can simply use start variable here. And to be more specific, I'll change these variable names as like this. Here we are using rowVal variable for each value of row. Similarly, colVal for each value of columns, and numRows to define the number of times the outer loop should run, and numCalls to define the number of times the inner loop should run. For simplicity, I use these two variables, numRows and numCalls. But as we know that both are containing the same value, we can use numbers here too instead of using these columns. Alright, enough talk. Can we guess what type of pattern we already printed here? Absolutely right. We printed our solid square pattern. We just need to print here asterisk or star symbol instead of printing this value. Now when we run this code again, we get our solid square pattern printed. Now let's move to print the next pattern. Alright, so as we already write our code to print the solid square pattern, now we'll see how can we write our code to print this hollow square pattern. Here the number of rows are 7, where the value of a row will vary from 1 to 7 and the value of column will also vary from 1 to 7. Now if we analyze this problem, we can simply say that print stars or any pattern symbol if and only if the value of column is 1 and also for the last value of the column, and in this case it is nothing but the 7, which is same as our number of rows. Similarly, this is also true for values of rows, as you can see in this picture. If this is not the case, print these spaces instead of printing the pattern symbol. This type of behavior, for example executing some part of code only when the particular condition is true and executing another part when it is false, can be achieved by using the conditional statement as like this one. Here, if block will only get executed when the value of some condition variable evaluates to true, otherwise else part get executed. So now let's write our code for this example. Here this code is written for printing our solid square pattern. I just add this pattern symbol variable here so that we can change value of this variable to print any symbol. Now as we already derived our condition for printing hollow square pattern, we'll use those conditions here. This is how if blocks will looks like. Here inside this if block, we'll use these four conditions in this way. These are nothing but the OR operators. You can find some links in the description to get more into it. But these operators are used for separating multiple conditions. And when either of these conditions evaluates to true, this if block get executed. Otherwise, these else blocks will get the chance to execute its statements. Let's run it. We'll get this output because we haven't write any statement inside the else block. But as we know that other than these values, we need to print spaces. Therefore, here inside this else block, I'll use one printf statement, or we can say printf functions, to print these spaces. Now run it again and we get our output. Here we return our code to print hollow square pattern. Now let's see the next example. Now we'll see how can we approach to write the code for printing this pattern. Here also the number of rows are 7. By carefully looking this picture, we can conclude that this pattern is very similar to this one that we already printed earlier. Only this part is different here. It means that all the conditions of the hollow square pattern will also be valid for this pattern. Now we just need to find some way to print these two parts there. These both values are approximately half of the value of numbers, as you can see here. But in C, when we perform any arithmetic division on integer number, it will round off the decimal values and return only the integer part, as I am showing here. Now looking at these values, we can easily construct our remaining conditions as like this. It means that we need to include these two more conditions with our four previous conditions inside the if block. That's all. Now we already derived all the conditions that will sufficient to print this hollow square with cross pattern. Alright, so let's see how can we write our code for this problem. Here this is the code that we wrote for printing hollow square pattern in our previous example. Now as we have these two more conditions here, just write these conditions inside this if block in this way. And now run the code and see the output. This is nothing but our hollow square with cross pattern. Now let's write our code for the final pattern. Alright, so finally we reach here to print this last pattern. As before, these four conditions will remain the same since we need hollow square here too. Now we need to first focus on this part of the pattern. Here we can clearly see that the pattern symbol is printed or the star is printed only when the value of row is same as the value of column. Means print pattern symbol when the value of row well is 1 and the corresponding value of col well is also 1. Similarly, when the row well is 2, col well should also has the same value as 2. And for row well 3, the corresponding col well should also be 3 and so on. It means that we found our first extra condition that will look something like this. Now we only need to drive our second condition to print this diagonal. Consider this figure here. We need to find some condition to print this star at these places. Is there any similarities between these values that will become our base condition? Let's see together. Here when the value of row well is 1, corresponding value of col well is 7. Similarly, for the row well 2, col well is 6, and for the row well 3, col well is 5, and so on. It means that in every iteration, value of row well get incremented and the value of col well get decremented. Consider these values here. We need to find some relation between these values. Let's give it a try. As we can see here now, for row well 1, col well should be 7, or we can say it is same as the number of rows, that is 7 right now. Our first equation looks something like this. Here we need to use both variables row well and as well as col well because our condition will depend on both of these values. Let's do dry run on it. For row well 1, col well is 7 as it is same as numrows because adding and then subtracting the row well, only numrows will remain the same. Now, when the value of row well is 2, but this time we required col well as 6, means this condition will not work here. Now we drive our second condition like this. Why I'm doing this all? Because at the end we need to find some condition which will relate these both variables. Only then we will be able to print this diagonal. Alright, so here when the value of row well is 1, col well will be 7. That's good. But for row well 2, col well again fails here because we get col well as 8 instead of 6. But looking at these values, what we can do is instead of adding row well to numrows, we can subtract it from the numrows in this way. Let's dry run it. For row well 1, col well is 7, it's fine. And for row well 2, col well is 6, and this is what we want here. And again for row well 3, col well is 5, and so on, means we found our second condition by using this relation between them. So now we can say that this is our second and the last condition. Here I just swapped these parts to make this more readable. Now let's give it a try. Here again I am using the same code which we had written for our hollow square pattern. Now I just include these two more conditions in this if block. Just run it and see the output. Congratulations, we did it. We successfully wrote our code to print these square patterns. Thanks for the patience. If you like this tutorial, please click on the like button and share it with your friends. Also subscribe the channel and don't forget to press the bell icon to never miss out any incoming videos like this one. And that being said, see you in the next video.